here in Red River Gorge, the geological area. And obviously it's not a normal way that you'd start a video, but I drove down yesterday. It took me a little longer to get down here. There was some traffic. And so I was really pushing it up against the sunset. So I didn't have a whole lot of time at the trail. I had to do much more than change into my clothes and hike in. Wanted to make sure I got camp set up before it was dark and make sure I had a way to, or a place that I could set everything up. So I got in, kind of checked in with the wife and crashed. And so here I am now, this next morning. Weather's, let's see, it's early June 2020. Weather's really kind of nice, but the geological area here is usually a little humid. And it's delivering here again. It's cool, but humid. And so I've got my coffee. I'm just hanging out here in the hammock. I thought I'd start the video and show you a little bit about this trip. So this trip started about, I don't know, maybe 3 days ago. We're in the middle of this whole COVID-19 thing. Things are starting to kind of open up again. And just been feeling a little cooped up and been gathering some things for a camping trip, but really haven't had much of an opportunity to get away. I was supposed to go backpacking with my brother the week in March, or the weekend in March, when the governor of Michigan shut down all the schools. And so of course that created a lot of work trying to figure out what we were going to do from there. So that trip didn't happen, and so here I am today, finally getting away, which is nice. Feels so good to be back out here, and looking forward to walking today. You know, you wouldn't think about all the challenges that we would have faced with COVID-19, and I know this is like kind of minor, but just one of those things where trying to get backpacking food, and there's all the mountain houses and everything else have been bought up by people who got a little fearful about the food situation. So over the last month or so, I've been dehydrating some food. I've been trying out some new recipes. We'll see how those work. So I did not bring any mountain houses on this trip. All I brought really was, well, my Pop-Tarts for breakfast, of course, and coffee. But other than that, it's all dehydrated from home. So hopefully it rehydrates well and the recipes worked out. And certainly cheaper to do it that way. It takes a little bit more work, but it's probably healthier to do it that way too. So, well, I'm going to pack up here and we'll talk a little more once we get on the trail. As you're hiking along here in the Red River Gorge geological area, if you don't look up, a lot of times you miss these kind of formations. They're everywhere. And you could see there, it's just gorgeous. You know, and a lot lot of times when you're hiking, got your head down, kind of watching where your feet are going. This is the kind of place I just, I don't know, I think it deserves more of a saunter than a hike. You know, you're not really trying to get anywhere as much as you're trying just to soak in all of what nature's got to offer here. So the other thing that's kind of interesting is this, so this rock overhang, you see it's dripping, and look at the power of water here. Everywhere where it's dripping, it's got these little pits that it's digging slowly over time, just little holes. So again, just it's a steamy morning. My glasses keep fogging up on me. One of the problems, I guess, with wearing glasses. So that video that I was showing back there is a part of this. Well, this is called the Daniel Boone National Forest, is in this area. So kind of the stomping grounds of Daniel Boone. Sorry about that. I had a trail runner coming at me, so had to pause for a hot second there. Anyway, Daniel Boone National Forest, that area that I was just showing you, is the what they call the Daniel Boone Hut. Apparently in 1959, somebody found a piece of wood that had D. Boone carved into it, so they think that might have been some place that Daniel Boone took shelter in, that little rock outcropping there. They haven't been able to confirm it, so who knows, but anyway, it's part of what I love about being out on trail, is just thinking about the history of people who've walked before me and people 100 years from now that'll walk after me. So one thing about those cliffs there, the sheer faces like what you see there, is every so often on this trail, you'll come across something like this, because you gain elevation so quickly. They put this in to help you out. You can see this is level straight ahead, and the top of that cliff is up there. So you see here, a little garbage thing I came up to, a road here. I think it's called Tunnel Something Road. It goes over top of the tunnel. It doesn't go under it, but I drove in on the one that goes under it. Anyway, I came to a trailhead parking lot here, and so I figured I'd drop my garbage off. There's no use in carrying it any further than I have to. I'll have more as I go along, but might as well get rid of it while I can. So as I leave this trailhead, I'm doing a little bit of a road hike here. I've got to get down to Pinch 'em Tight Trail here, so it's down this way, down the road. But back at that trailhead, they have, I wouldn't say restrooms, but vault toilets. So it's kind of nice if you save yourself from having to dig a cat hole. They also have a nice picnic area. There are lots of people hanging out and enjoying a picnic. It's a little early for lunch for me, but I'll just keep on walking. But one of the things that was there is, you know, they set up these rules in a place like this to protect the national forest, to protect the landscape and that. And, you know, back at that trailhead, there's a guy who was set up camp right there, right at the trailhead, which, you know, obviously doesn't fit with those rules, and everybody's got to figure out their own thing, but I'm pretty sure there's a reason they make up those rules, and it's about taking care of this space. And then some guy throws up a hammock right at the trailhead. Here we are, pinch 'em tight trail. I'm not sure why that's called that, but hey, if I find out, I'll show you. I just stepped off the trail for a minute there and caught this beautiful view. Just walking along a ridge kind of here, and as you can see, here's, I don't know if the camera's gonna do it justice, but it just drops off right there. That might be why we pinch it tight if you're afraid of heights. You don't want to get too close to that edge. So I'm on Buck Trail right now. Comes off of Pinch'em Tight, which is also the Sheltoway Trace. So I originally planned to start on the other side of the park here, but what ended up happening is I got a late start leaving home, and then ended up running into a traffic jam in Lexington. So I ended up hitting the trail quite a bit later than I expected. I probably started walking at about 8:30 at p.m. in early June, and I didn't really know where I was headed as far as where I was going to actually camp. So I just kind of knew I'd walk in far enough to just to set up camp and get a place to sleep for the night. But I didn't want to take the extra time to drive to the other side of the park, which is where I had planned to start. So it's no big deal. It just switches things up a little bit. I ended up at starting at the Martin's Fork trailhead. Hiked in like to the little split somewhere near where it goes off to Gray's Arch. I just kind of took a walk off into the woods and found a little flat spot where I could set up my hammock and make a place to stay for the night. Interesting though, I found it. I was kind of excited about it and set everything up, and but it was on a little bit of an incline, which, you know, for a hammock's no big deal because you're just hanging between trees anyway. But I grabbed a few snacks and went to hang my food, and crazy enough, I found a nice flat campsite. Clearly people had been there before, probably thrown up some tents or a fire pit and everything else, just about 50 yards from where I ended up setting up. So it was no big deal. It definitely was more of a tent site than a hammock site, but anyway, just a lesson to my future self to maybe do a little more scouting around the area to find the best spot, not just settle for the first spot. But like I said, I was worried about the time, so it all worked out. I got everything set up and before the sun went down, which was really what I was trying to do, so. So this morning, I broke one of my cardinal rules. I felt pretty comfortable about doing it, but I did it anyway, and it wasn't a problem. But one of the things I always try and do is make sure that when I'm at a water source that I fill up, and I make sure that I've got my water ready to go, because I've been burnt way too many times in the past where I thought I'd have another water source coming up. I didn't take the time to do it, and I ended up going a long distance without additional water, which is not a good thing to do when you're hiking, especially a place like this where it's hot and humid and you're sweating pretty profusely all day long. So anyway, this morning I camped near a water source and I did not fill up, but I felt pretty confident that I'd probably be at another water source shortly after that. I just didn't want to take the time and slow things down this morning. So it didn't cost me anything, but still a good rule, I think, to follow. And I'm going to do that here. I'm going to fill up and make sure it's a good time for a break and grab a snack, give me a chance to fill up my water and carry on. So a couple other things about water while I'm on the topic. The other thing I do, I know a lot of backpackers do this, but when I get to a water source, I always drink as much water as I possibly can. Rehydrate myself while I'm sitting right at the water source. I fill up, or I get as much water as I think I'm going to need for until I get to the next water source, at least a liter. But I do have two 1 liter bottles like this that I use, and I can fill those up. When I start getting close to camp, I might also fill up my water, my dirty water bladder. That's 3 liters. So that potentially I can walk into camp with 5 liters if I needed to. I don't know what I'd do with 5 liters of water, but who knows? I mean, if I want to take a shower, I suppose I could do that with that. But anyway, I always fill up, drink as much water as I can. Almost make myself sick with water. I get to a point where I don't really want anymore, and then I fill up my 1 liter bottle, maybe two, and continue hiking on. One last thing on the water. I used to use a bladder that was in my backpack. It was a 3 liter bladder that had like the tube that would come up, and I really liked it, and the fact that I was able to just kind of, while I was hiking, I could drink water pretty much constantly as I was going. But there are a few limitations with that made me switch. One was, I had a situation where a hose came off in my, let's see if I can find the trail here. Well, I thought I knew where the trail was. I'll be right back. All right, sorry about that. Took me a quick second. I did know where the trail is. It just crossed the water here. Of course, made it a little more challenging to see. But anyway, what I was sharing was about the water. So I used to use that water bladder. But I can't tell you how many times I'd be going, and because I was just constantly sucking on that thing, I didn't realize that I had run out of water. And so I'd just be going along, I'd be nowhere near a water source, be sucking on that thing, and all of a sudden it's dry. And, I just didn't like that. I didn't like the fact that I never knew how much water I had left, and then I can't remember if I mentioned this before. I realized that I didn't really know where I was, and then I was right where I thought I was. But anyway, the other Hold on, got another water crossing here. But the other one thing was, is one time I was filling it up and the hose came off, so I ended up getting my backpack soaked, and I didn't really realize it. So I went to grab water, and again, it was empty. So I opted for these. This is, they hang on the front of the pack. You can buy one, you can get two. I bought one off of, or I bought them both off of a guy on a Facebook group that I'm a part of. But I love it. I always know how much water I have. It's easy to drink while I'm hiking along. And it's lighter than the integrated bladder that I had. And then the other bonus is that it acts kind of as a counterbalance on the front of the pack. So it gives you a little weight on the front that helps to kind of balance the weight on the back in your backpack. So anyway, I know everybody does their own thing, but the system I got here seems to work well for me, and thought I'd just share with you why I do it. So I just came up Buck Trail. I'm on Coomer Ridge Trail now. I can go to the right. There's a campground down there about a mile and a half, but there's an arch over there, a little geological feature that, I don't know, I might just walk over there and see what it is. It looks like it's about a mile away, so that'll add a couple miles today, but I'll be back by this sign later because I'm headed to the rough trail eventually, but for right now, I think I'm going to go check out Hidden Arch, which is that-a-way. So I'm hiking now along the Hidden Arch Loop. So I hope it's not too hidden that I can't see it. Be good to see the arch at some point here. Probably not going to video as I go down the steps. It's a pretty steep set of steps, so I'm just gonna get to stepping. So I don't know if this is Hidden Arch. I basically came up these steps here, saw that arch, and I'm gonna continue up those steps there. After Hidden Arch, I came up to Coomer Ridge Trail. This is the Coomer Ridge Campground. And so I just walked into one of their campsites. This is one of their doubles. So they've got two tent platforms here. I don't know if it'd be great for a hammock, but anyway, they got a fire pit and a couple of picnic tables. So I figured I'll have lunch here. After breakfast this morning, I cold soaked some dehydrated burrito mix, but it's still not the right consistency. So I'm gonna fire up the stove here, heat up a little water, put it in there, get it to where I want it, and have some lunch. Just walking along Coomer Ridge Trail, headed to Rough Trail. One of the things about Red River Gorge here at the geological area is a lot of it is flat, and then you just descend down into these valleys, and then it's flat again, and then every so often you'll have you know, an ascent from the valley up to the ridge. So, you know, 100, 200, 300 feet up or down, and then it's flat for a lot after that. So it's quite a contrast from the White Mountains, where you could go up for hours or down for hours. Here you're kind of flat for a lot more of it. You still go up and down, but certainly not the same kind of elevation. Well, probably somewhere around 10 miles in today, and I found this view. So I sat down, enjoyed some water, and let me flip you around so you can see it. Not a lot of clear views like this out here. This one's gorgeous. Video I recorded, it was about 3:30 today, and that was Hansen's Point, which is not actually an official trail, but it's a pretty solidly used trail out here. And so I walked out there. There's a whole bunch of campsites up here. I mean, it's a pretty popular place for people to come for the weekend, and so I walked all the way out there. There were campers, pretty much people camping all the way from here to there, but spent some time out on the point and then walked back. And there's this beautiful spot right here just before just off the trail here by Hansen's Point that run over by ants here. So anyway, so I walked back here. I set up my hammock and changed into my evening clothes. I laid down for a little bit, and now I'm getting into some dinner. I rehydrated some spaghetti, and I cold soaked the meat sauce after lunch, and I just kind of carried it with me. And then when I got here, I cooked up the noodles and put some of that hot water in there. So it's a good day today. At about almost 13 miles of hiking in. So found this beautiful campsite, and I thought, well, there's no point in keep walking. I missed a turnoff. A little disappointed. I missed a turnoff somewhere along the hike there, and I was gonna head north on the Sheltowee Trace Trail. But anyway, I was disappointed I missed a trail. I was supposed to go off. I was going to head north on the Sheltowee Trace Trail and just kind of head up, get a few extra miles in for tomorrow. But I ended up making a left-hand turn instead of a right-hand turn, and came up here, and I'm going to camp here at Hansen's Point now. So this is the end of the first full day, and I've been doing everything I can to try and stay awake, because all I really want to do is go to bed, but I'll be up by 3 a.m, and I don't want to start hiking that early. So see you tomorrow. Good morning. Well, it's the morning of day 2, and just sitting here in the hammock enjoying a little bit of coffee and breakfast. I got up about half an hour ago, about 6:30. It was a warm night last night. I had to use my bug net, which blocks some of the air, and it was nice. I woke up this morning and it was a nice little breeze, so it's pretty comfortable now, but I was sweating a little bit through the night. Still got a good night's sleep though. Something about sleeping in the hammock just feels so good. I don't know what that is, but. So the plan today, I guess, is changed a little bit. I plan to walk all day today, but I'm going to end up making it back to the car sooner than I thought, which is, I don't know, feels a little disappointing. So I may just hike by Gray's Arch. And then from there, I think I'll probably be back at the car. And then a few places that I haven't been to here that I figured I'd go visit that are kind of drive-to features of Red River Gorge. So maybe I'll do some of those and just do some day hike type stuff and then find another place to camp for the night. And we'll just kind of play it by ear, see how the day plays out. Plodding along here, headed over to Gray's Arch, and you know, it's kind of funny. I'm starting to pass, it's Sunday, so I'm starting to pass a number of day hikers. And I gotta tell you, after being in the woods for a couple of nights, I smell like the great outdoors. But I can smell these day hikers coming from a mile away. Smell like soap and shampoo and perfume and cologne and everything else. Like, kind of funny because you don't notice that in your daily life much, but you're out on the trail. It's quite an assault to the nose. Of course, I might be too. Anyway, it's the other thing that's kind of funny is last night I was up at Hanson's Point, which is a pretty popular place out here. So lots of spaces, probably better part of 50 campsites up there if somebody, you know, people came up. So, but I ended up in a area that was pretty much all by myself. And I purposely kind of came away from Hanson's Point a little bit to be by myself. And, you know, people came up and they're like, well, we could camp here, but let's see if we can go up a little further, a little closer to Hanson's Point. But I think nobody wanted to camp next to the creepy old man by himself in his hammock there. So I guess it's to my benefit to be an old solo hiker. Ended up having the campsite all to myself. It's kind of nice. So I'm at the intersection for Gray's Arch. If I go up this way, I'm going up on the arch. If I go the down that way, I'll be able to look up at it. Back at the trailhead, and I ended up being about, I made a wrong turn. I planned to go and add some miles, but didn't, I missed that turn off, so I didn't add those miles. So I ended up back at my car sooner than I expected. So, but whatever, it is what it is. Enjoyed the trip, and I'm gonna go check out the rest of this park and see what else there is to see.